leading the revolution of talk radio.
Lynn Cullen.
Hello there, and welcome back. I sort of feel like I'm cleaning up today. I've got all these sort of disconnected things that I just want to throw your way and see if it engenders any conversation. I also want to remind you that tomorrow we'll have John Delano talking about the import of Tuesday's election. And we'll also have Devra Davis, who is the author of, why am I blanking on the name of the book? She's the one who's getting a lot of attention because of this book she's done on our war on cancer, which she said has been badly mismanaged, like another war I can think of, another few wars I can think of, actually. And some have, you know, there's a lot of reaction to this book. Some are praising her as akin to Rachel Carson, sounding the alarm about the fact that much of our cancers are clearly, or probably clearly, if we would just do the research to find out, environmentally caused. And she charges that governments and corporations have been behind a concerted effort to prevent the kind of research that needs to be done, and instead have decided to continue making money selling products that in all likelihood contribute to cancer, and then also making money by manufacturing drugs that supposedly cure the cancer. Isn't that wonderful? There actually are some corporations that play both sides. They, you know, they create products that in all likelihood cause cancer, and then they also create pharmaceuticals that supposedly fight it. Which you have to admit is a brilliant business plan. so she will be with us. She is a renowned epidemiologist, and although, as I said, the book is controversial, and other epidemiologists and people in the cancer fight have charged that she is a bit over the top, to say the least, and is a fanatic. So we'll see. My guess is probably the truth is somewhere in between. She'll be here at 10 o'clock tomorrow. And then, of course, we have our usual animals. So, that's what's coming up tomorrow. Today, it's just been you and me, and I've been doing my best to depress the heck out of you, but I don't know. How am I doing? And this is what Ed Koch always used to say. Speaking of Ed Koch, former mayor of New York, he's very happy today because he, as before he was mayor of New York, he was a congressman. He was in the House of Representatives from New York City, and he, along with Bella Abzug, remember Bella? The year would be 1974, put a bill in the hopper that would have made it illegal, federal law, make it illegal to discriminate against gay people because they were gay. It was called the Employment Non-Discrimination Act, and it didn't have a chance. It, in fact, rarely even came up for a vote, and when it did, it was clobbered. So Koch is thrilled because it came up again, and it was passed, since 74 years. So what is that, 33 years? After it was initially proposed, this bill did pass the House of Representatives, granting protections against discrimination in the workplace for gay men, lesbians, and bisexuals. It had some Republican support. In fact, 35 Republicans joined 200 Democrats in putting this measure through. Generally, polls of Americans now show that a majority of Americans do agree with this legislation, that there should not be discrimination against homosexuals in terms of employment. Although a majority still oppose same-sex marriage, as I'm sure you know. Some of the Democrats who voted against it, and there were 25, voted against it not because they didn't think there should be this anti-discrimination law that would protect homosexuals, but rather because it did not protect enough people who were different in their sexual orientation, such as transgendered and transsexuals. And also, it turns out that the Republicans, get this. The Republicans mounted an effort during the debate on this issue, saying that they wanted to add an amendment to the bill that would, in fact, put that broader language in, that so that the bill would protect transsexuals, transvestites, who knows what else, blah, 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 blah. The Republicans were arguing they wanted that in the bill. Can you figure that out? Come on. You can figure that out. Because they figured if it were in the bill then would die. They didn't really want the bill broadened. They just wanted a bill that it would have been easier to defeat. Those Republicans, I'll tell you, they're always trying. They're always using every little trick that they can. It did not work. The only reason the bill did pass is because they removed that broader language that would have granted these the protection to transsexuals and transvestites. So the Republicans' effort to put that language back in was not because they'd all of a sudden decided that they were a gay-friendly party, but rather they knew that that would do it in. A lot of municipalities already have such legislation. I believe Pittsburgh is one. A number of states also have this type of legislation, but the federal at the federal level, there has not been. And so it goes on to the Senate now, where its chances of passage are very good. It already has a Republican co-sponsor there in Senator Susan Collins. So it looks like this baby's going. It'll go straight to the White House. And what do you think will happen to it there? That's what I think, too. I suppose he'll veto it. Okay, and now to my friends on the left who love Hugo Chavez. I just, you know, guys, I've been telling you for a long time, this guy is, can't you see, a despot in the making? Can't you see it? You embrace him because he hates George Bush. But I'm telling you, that doesn't work. He's bad to the bone. He was meant to be a dictator. He's built to be a dictator. He will be a dictator. Well, I just want to bring you up to speed on those of you who still love him. What's going on in Venezuela these days? And don't tell me I'm somehow being misled by Western media. One of the guys that has been with him for a long time, pretty much his right-hand man, is, in fact, the guy that was his defense minister, Raul Bajuel. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. Bajuel has been with him for so long that he, in fact, was responsible in large part for saving Chavez in 2002 when there was an unsuccessful coup d'etat against him. Chavez was briefly knocked out of office, but regained the office in large part because this guy, Bajuel, brought the military in on Chavez's behalf, and they got Chavez back in power. And this is actually before he was his defense chief. He was in the military, and he then was promoted up and up the chain of command, and in 2006 was named Chavez's defense minister. He has been seen as absolutely the right-hand man to Hugo Chavez up until the other day, when Bajuel came out and said, speaking of coup d'etats, that if all of these proposed changes in the Venezuelan Constitution were allowed to go forward, this is Bajuel's words, it would in effect finalize a coup d'etat. And he said the Venezuelan people should categorically reject this fraud. The fraud he speaks of is changing the Venezuelan constitution. So essentially, Hugo Chavez can be president for as long as he wants. And he can essentially have complete control of everything. He can impose a state of emergency like another good, wonderful leader, Musharraf, has done. He can shut down the news media. He can suspend individual rights. He can, in fact, replace all governors and mayors with his own people. And, in fact, much of this has already come to pass. The Supreme Court is already totally in the hands of Chavez's guys. The parliament, the National Assembly, is as well. And so this is, it's a done deal. However, you have people in Venezuela, like this former defense secretary, who now, by the way, Hugo Chavez is calling a traitor. And I think this guy better get the hell out of the country fast, because he's going to be a dead man. You have students on almost every campus, college campus in the country, protesting yesterday. And you have at the most prestigious university there, masked gunmen shooting into the crowds of students. The students were protesting, and they were protesting peacefully, this referendum, which will essentially give Hugo Chavez what he wants, which is Venezuela. So I just want to tell you that's what's happening, and how anybody can still support somebody like him is beyond me. I guess because he says he's a socialist, and if you're a lefty, you think that's wonderful. This is how socialism has to come, with masked gunmen, with the removal of anything that we would recognize as democracy, with shutting down of news media, with terrorizing of populations. This is how socialism comes? Then you can stuff it. I'm Lynn Cullen. It's AM News Talk 1360. You know, we were speaking of the Berlin Wall before, and I don't want to get back into that Gorbachev-Reagan thing, but that was in the last hour. But there's this interesting piece from the Guardian in the UK, a survey taken of Germans. And this is fascinating. More than one in five Germans would like to see the Berlin Wall rebuilt. That's, I guess, the 18th anniversary of its fall is coming up. And so there was a poll done of, you know, attitudes of Germans in the ensuing 18 years and whether they think it was a good idea that wall went down or not. And amazingly, you have that large a number. Now, I'm not sure exactly where that's coming from. The desire to see the wall returned is as high among former citizens of communist East Germany as it is among those from the West. In fact, the number of East Germans, who now, of course, are simply Germans again, only 3% of people who were in East Germany say they were very satisfied with the way that German democracy works. So 3% saying they were very satisfied, that's all. But that's normal. I mean, I'm sure a lot more said they were satisfied, at least, or were okay. 73% of those from East Germany said that they believed that socialism was a good idea, but had been poorly implemented. And, yeah, see, that's the problem. And that's what we see happening in Venezuela. If that's socialism, to hell with it. Over 90% of the former East Germans said that they had a lot better social protection in East Germany than they do now in Democratic Germany. What else? The overwhelming majority of people originating in West Germany who were surveyed said that if the wall ever went up again, they want to stay in West Germany. And as many as 36% of former East Germans said that if the wall were put up again, they would like to be in the communist East. So that's more than a third of the East Germans, the former East Germans, saying if the wall were back up, I'd go back to the East. That's fascinating. A German cultural historian told Der Spiegel, the magazine, that most young people born in East Germany had no connection to their origins. There are no cultural roots with which they can positively identify. Who knows? I don't know what. Whatever. So, I mean, who knows? You'll have a bunch of East Germans saying, Mr. President, put back that wall! Here's Claire. Hi, Claire.
Oh, my goodness. It's all upside down, inside out.
I'll tell you, I can't keep track of it anymore.
And 180 degrees out of phase. Yeah. People need to, in the analysis of any of this, divorce economic socialism from what the constitutional and democratic trappings of government that, may be that are riding next to it. You have democratic socialisms. You have one very economically attractive, taking American factories away because they guarantee health care right up in Canada.
Correct.
You have Scandinavia.
Yeah.
You have Israel. You have Britain. You have all of the European Union, every developed country except
that managed to do socialism and democracy.
Yes. They do them both in parallel together.
Right.
Now, you're saying that you have trouble. I don't know what kind of limousine liberals you're hanging out with here, Lynn. These people that are still apologizing for Chavez as he's marching toward president for life, which I always thought was a neat oxymoron, and, you know, and that craziness. Here, they love Chavez because they hate George Bush.
That's right. And they,
now, Chavez is moving toward an oil-fed, redistributionist dictatorship.
Yes.
George Bush considers himself a family member, a brother of an oil redistributionist dictatorship,
right,
called Saudi Arabia.
Correct.
So all you got to do is change the clothes. And George Bush loves Hugo Chavez. Now, how are you going to love Hugo Chavez for hating Bush when Bush indeed loves him, at least at its capitalist base? You see what I mean?
I do. But I think some people are so blinded by their hatred for Bush and sometimes for their just refusal to ever acknowledge that the United States has done anything right anywhere.
Well, there is some of that, but on the practical side, people who are, you know, economics uberalis, economics are the only thing that matters and we'll tolerate anything else,
right.
You just read that with the East Germans, that they would sacrifice civil liberties in order to get economic stability.
Right, and security. Right.
Yeah,
right.
And, you know, it sort of runs opposite of the freedom, you know, the freedom quotient of Benjamin Franklin that we bring up
right. So
often. They would exchange liberty and freedom if they could just get some economic stability over there. And
that's correct. That
indeed is a shame.
But well, you know what is interesting is that's what the Russian people are doing now.
Yes, yes.
They love Putin. Because they're feeling richer and they're feeling and they don't care if they don't have civil liberties. They never did,
and it's
so they don't miss them.
The same ham-handed. Well, he might be kicking butt, but he's doing it on our behalf to keep us safe. The same thing that they put on Bush, which is ridiculous. I would rather put a Bella Abzug hat on Bush because I not only remember her, but I remember her hats.
Yeah, yeah.
And those were cool. And music, poetry. When you're getting depressed, consider this. A lot of times people think that it's, you know, working class, southern, rural people that are suckered in by the right-wing arguments. Listen to bluegrass. Listen to folk music. Listen to poets that come from the country. They are on our side. They may still hunt bunnies. They may still do things that are very much in the country scheme of things. They may sing a lot of religious hymns and go to the Baptist church. But they are on our side of all of this political argument. If only we would listen to them and see where the points of agreement are. And it gives me a lot of hope for the future that we can unplug this silly, silk-stocking, corporatist, take over the Republican Party and thereby the fear mechanism and the United States.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Go on in merriment and joy or something like that. Or perhaps some chemical substitutes, therefore.
All righty.
Just talk to your local pharmaceutical company.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay.
All right. Bye. That would not be big pharma. That would be small. Independent pharma, I guess. I'm Lynn Cullen, and I got to get a mid-break in here, and what's the Dow doing? It's going down. Sure. Okay, and my future with it. Oh, what the heck. Let's take a break. Oh, I was just looking up at the screen, and Bernie Kerik is not going to be indicted today. I said he would. Tomorrow, looks like. Rudy's good buddy. Okay. I haven't done this in a long time, and the reason is I haven't done it in a long time because the last month, October, was, thankfully, I'm looking for the right word, one of the lowest months since the start of the war in terms of American dead. And I don't know. I have such, that's the good news. And then the news yesterday comes out that while last month was one of the lowest, this year, 2007, which of course is not over, is already the worst year of the war in terms of American deaths. And in large part, I think if you were to look at a graph, the spike in deaths came at the beginning of the surge. And about 2-3 months into the surge, there was just a horrific death toll. And since the surge has resulted in, a tamping down of some of the militias and groups and insurrectionists where the surge is underway, you're now seeing the more positive effects, I hope, of that. I've been reading a lot lately about what's going on there, and a lot of credit from a lot of people going to Petraeus for doing something that nobody else before him was willing to do, which is talking to the bad guys. One of the reasons that things are tamping down is he's willing to work with anybody who's willing to work with him. And so you have the situation in Anbar where before, excuse me, we were not willing to approach the Sunni insurgents because we saw them as our enemy. They were killing American soldiers. We had them to deal with. We had the Shiite militias, and we had the Al-Qaeda in Iraq. And they were all the bad guys. We were fighting everybody. Then there was a rift that developed between the Sunnis and Al-Qaeda in Iraq, who are also Sunnis. When the Al-Qaeda guys started, you know, beheading everybody left and right and blowing people up, the other Sunnis said, hey, wait a minute, and started to fight them. Well, as soon as they started fighting Al-Qaeda, we saw them as potential allies, even though they also were, just a minute before, killing our soldiers. Petraeus has been willing to make these alliances in as much as they, at the time, will benefit us. That's exactly what the Sunnis are doing now, too, and I maintain that as soon as we stop aiding the Sunnis, or the Sunnis start helping us, this, you know, the worm will turn again. So I don't know how. I don't know. I ain't celebrating yet. Let's put it that way. I see so much of this as sort of a temporary thing before the next alliance, occurs or breaks down. There are so many interests at work there. And in large part, none of them want us there. They want us there in as much as we serve their interests. And right now, the Sunnis are hanging on to us because we think we're funding them. This is causing a lot of trouble with the mostly Shiite-dominated government, which is a total. There's essentially no government there at all. And since almost everybody who looks at this say this is a war that will never be won militarily, it will only be won politically, you cannot, I don't know how you can feel sort of positive about it when you have no government there. You have little places. You have Anbar here and you've got this place here, but that's not a nation. There is no national government that everybody recognizes. So I know there's efforts on some to say, see, it's working. Listen, we've been in this for how long now? 4 years and counting, heading into 5 years. A few months of anything is not enough to, say we're heading in the right direction. I don't know. I have loved watching these numbers of our soldiers going down, although the last few days have been horrific again. I mean, in today's paper alone, there were 9 names listed. So here it starts again. So even though October looked good, we're already looking at a November that's not looking so good. So I don't know. But I have not been reading the names. Because when I do, it sort of interrupts the show. And I'm not going to do that with just one or two names. I sort of wait. Isn't it awful? I wait until they pile up. I also wanted to share this with you because I once said, what do you, last time I read the names, I said, what do you think of when I'm reading those names? Because I know all kinds of things go on in my head. And got a lot of responses, mostly email responses, but I got one poetic response. And I want to share it with you first, and then I'll read the latest names. This was written by C.J. Kazmarczyk and dedicated to each of the names and their families and for all of the brave and fallen soldiers of the Iraq War. And he did this in response to my question, what do you think of when you hear the names? And this is his poem, The Reading of the Names. Today again, I humbly bow my head as I sadly hear more of the same. From a broadcast over local radio of the constant growing list and the mournful reading of the names. Over and over again, inside and out, I catch myself so angry and inflamed, anguishing over the needless sacrifice of brave young soldiers and to hear the mournful reading of their names. Do we as a people or a nation have no conscience or no shame? Do we not weep or feel heartache when we hear this continuing and mournful reading of the names? Mr. Bush, Iraq is not a contest. No, sir, it's not some game. This just cause you advocate just promotes more death and the mournful reading of the names. And so, Mr. President, tell me who is it that is truly to blame for the sorrow and the reasons that cause hollowness deep inside and the mournful reading of the names? Is it you? Is it me? Is it all of us? Was it 9/11 or WMDs you claimed? Is it revenge or fortune for the few that outweighs the loss of many and their mournful reading of the names? Till I know the answer, I'll ask of our Lord each brave soldier's soul to reclaim and pray for the day we never have to hear another single grieving voice lament in mourning the reading of the names. The Department of Defense has now identified 3,852 American service members who have died since the start of the Iraq War. These are the most recent confirmed deaths. Kevin Bewley, 27, Petty Officer, 2nd Class, Navy, Hector, Arkansas. Carletta Davis, 34, Staff Sergeant, Army, Anchorage. John Lind, 30, Staff Sergeant, Army, New York. Adam J. Muller, 21, Private, Army, Underhill, Vermont. Christine Drury, 21, Specialist, Army, Dracut, Massachusetts. Daniel Shaw, 23, Sergeant, Army, West Seneca, New York. Derek Stenroos, 24, Sergeant, Army, North Pole, Alaska. Johnny Walls, 41, Sergeant, 1st Class, Army, Bremerton, Washington. Dwayne Covert Jr., 20, Private Army, Tonawanda, New York. Tracy Lynn Alger, 30, Second Lieutenant Army, New Auburn, Wisconsin. Louis Greasy, 30, Sergeant Army, Sturgeon Bay, Wisconsin. Timothy McGovern, 28, Corporal Army, Idaville, Indiana. Brandon Smitherman, 21, Specialist Army, Conroe, Texas. Cody Carver, 19, Private Army, Haskell, Oklahoma. Thomas Crowell, 36, Master Sergeant Air Force, Neosho, Missouri. Rush Jenkins, 22, Private Army, Clarksville, Tennessee. Daniel McCall, 24, Sergeant Army, Pace, Florida. David Wieger, 28, Staff Sergeant Air Force, North Huntington, Pennsylvania. Robin Towns, Sr., 52, Staff Sergeant, Army National Guard, Upper Marlboro, Maryland. Jared Fontenot, 35, Staff Sergeant, Army, Port Barre, Louisiana. Eric Garut, 22, Corporal, Marines, Santee, California. Wayne Geiger, 23, Specialist Army, Lone Pine, California. Vincent Madero, 22, Specialist Army, Port Huanim, not sure, California. Anna Marie Camacho, 20, Seaman Navy, Panama City, Florida. Janicia Gresham, 19, Seaman Navy, Lithonia, Georgia. Michael Brown, 20, Specialist Army, Williamsburg, Kansas. Adam Chichin, 39, Private Army, Philadelphia. David Lambert, 39, Specialist Army, Cedar Bluff, Virginia. All righty, we're back. The other troubling thing is this information out, Associated Press story that is in a lot of papers today, that they're saying now that veterans make up 1 in 4 of all the homeless people in this country. So 25% of the homeless are veterans, even though veterans are only 11% of the general population, and they're starting to see the inevitable growth now in veterans from this war that are turning up homeless. It usually takes a while after they're out for the downward spiral to occur. But to suggest that the experience of the war does not directly, is not a cause of what ends up as homelessness is, of course, absurd. It is. Often because of their psychological scars, they take to drugs, they take to alcohol, and the next thing you know, you're on the street. And so there, some people, Veterans Affairs, here's one quoted from Lancaster County saying, "We're going to have a tsunami of Iraqi veterans eventually, because the mental health toll from this war is enormous." So on this, as Veterans Day approaches, I think if there's anything we who like to say we support our troops, do we support them after they're back? Do we support them when they're spiraling down, when they need mental health care? Do we do that enough? So even though services for homeless veterans have probably improved since Vietnam, we've got to be vigilant about taking care of these people. Oh, no. Okay. Can't they get rid of him? I've got to leave immediately for that. I'll go down the stairs. He's up here. I'm going down the stairs. There's some weirdo in the waiting. He's waiting for me, huh? Is he?
And the best part is, the radio audience is now in on this. Well,
that's okay with me. I don't like people showing up unannounced like that. I don't, you know, and So, yeah, I'm hightailing it out of here. Okay. Here's Anthony in the South Hills. Hi. Anthony, are you there? He gave up. Okay. Oh. The owner of this station and many, many other stations, Tony Renda, is being honored this afternoon at the AIR Awards ceremony. This is where this benefits muscular dystrophy, right? And it is, you know, a big banquet. They hand out some awards. I never get one. No, I never get one. It's like the Academy Awards. I'm always nominated. I'm like Susan Lucci. I sit there. They read my name, and then they announce somebody else's. And you know, you have to smile and applaud and stuff. But Tony Renda is the big honoree, Lifetime Achievement Award honoree today. And what? This gets better and better. I'm going down this. I ain't coming out. Have someone, a large person, come and get him out of there. What? What did she just say? This is the receptionist trying to get rid of it. What? There's nobody here because they're all at the awards thing. Matt, suck it up and look real tough.
When was the last time that happened?
Well, Erica, I'm sorry. I ain't helping. I'm out of here. I'm hightailing it down the back stairs. We got trouble here. The place is deserted, huh? Everybody's at that thing.
Yeah, everybody's
for
at
Tony Renda. Yeah. Well, I've got to go there. I've got to get there immediately. Immediately, if not sooner.
Yeah, because that kicks off at noon.
So. I know. I'm supposed to be there now. I got to go do my Susan Lucci thing. I got to go lose again. Dang it. I hate this thing. It's nice Tony's getting awarded and all that kind of stuff. I'll go there for him. Otherwise, I just as soon go home so I don't have to applaud when somebody I don't particularly necessarily like gets the award I should get, right? I'm sorry. This is definitely just sort of devolved into nothingness here. And wish me luck in avoiding this strange person in the lobby. Okay. I'm getting the heck out of here. See you tomorrow.
We'll have to explain this at some point tomorrow.
We will? I don't know.
I'm just not sure how much the audience knows.
Look, there's a big guy. Okay. Goodbye.